Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining this 2022 Industry Tech Days live session brought to you by EE Tech and All About Circuits. My name is Dale Wilson, and I'll be your moderator for our next session. This session is brought to you by Eaton Electronic Components and is titled Addressing Noise Immunity Challenges of New Generation High-Speed Automotive Data Architectures Using Ethernet and Power-over-Coax. Let me tell you a bit about our presenter. Akos Labadi is a Senior Field Applications Engineer at Eaton. I've had the pleasure of talking technology with Akos before on All About Circuits Tech Chat, so I'm really looking forward to hearing from him again today in what promises to be an interesting session. We do have a couple of notes before we jump into the session. Following the presentation, we will have a live Q&A with Akos. You can submit your questions at any time during the presentation using the chat box on the right-hand side of your screen. And be sure to stick around for that Q&A, as we will also be announcing the winner of this live session's giveaway before it comes to a close. And near the end of the session, we will provide attendees a link where they can download a PDF version of Akos's presentation. So keep an eye out for that. And with that, thank you so much for joining us, and I'll hand it off to Akos for the presentation.
Yeah, good afternoon, good morning, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This is Akos Labadi speaking from Eaton Electronics, EMEA. I'm in a position of a senior field application engineer working mainly on automotive applications for automotive customers. And I'm happy to be here with you and talk about addressing noise immunity challenges of new generation high-speed automotive data architectures using Ethernet and power over coax. It was a quite long sentence to say out loud, but as you look at the content of today's presentation, we're going to be really focusing on just as I mentioned. I will start with a brief introduction of our Eaton Electronics business, and then briefly touching why automotive high-speed communication lines are needed. This is quite an obvious topic, so I just want to touch base on it. And then I will go deep inside of the filtering, noise immunity improvement, and filtering of the POC, and basically the mainly the 100 base T1 automotive Ethernet structures. So let's get started with Eaton Electronics. So Eaton Electronics is quite recent in terms of the name suggests. So Eaton is a large, long heritage electrical company focusing on power conversion, protection, and storage, and have been basically been on the market for more than 100 years. Where we come from as Eaton Electronics is mainly from Bussmann and Coltronics. So Coltronics, you may recall that it has been a primary developers for all kinds of magnetic components, mainly on the power electronics. But recently we have been basically developing products for filtering and the RF circuits. And that's something which we really want to emphasize now, that we are bringing now on the market, basically some advanced technologies and solutions in order to address the biggest challenges of today automobiles as well. In terms of our business, just real quick, we actually do power magnetics, circuit protection, and supercapacitors mainly, power magnetics being the dominant, so as you can see, like 55%. And in terms of the segments in Asia, we focus more on computing solutions, namely servers, and in like Europe and the Americas, it's mainly industrial, a little bit of consumer and transportation. In Europe, that's more than 50% of our basically focus and the products sold. As I mentioned, we have a wide range of passive components that we manufacture and develop. Magnetics is number one, so kinds of high current inductors and now being EMC and RF components as well. As well as circuit protection, so Bussmann being a leading brand of circuit protection, we do over current over voltage protection, as well as supercapacitors. We are the leading brand of supercaps as well, the largest portfolio worldwide, even though this is quite like a niche market. And we also have some terminal blocks and recently introduced some sensors. We have all these products having in some series automotive qualified, except of the terminal blocks. So we are a heavily focused supplier for passive components on automotive customers. If we look, we'll take a big look on an overview about the magnetics products that we make. We have basically started with power inductors back in the 1960s, being a primary developer of ferrites and ferrite-based solutions like shielded inductors, unshielded inductors. We did a lot of toroids back in the days. We do less and less. And recently, we started to focus in the last 20 years more on the high current, so molded inductors, as well as all kinds of specialized ferrite, clip, flatpack style inductors, which is also a trademark from Eaton. And obviously, transformers with a very long heritage. Also for power and current sense and a lot of customs. And the recent additions are basically the RF, so chip inductors, ferrite beads, and a lot of EMC components for all kinds of noise addressing and DC-DC converters as well. So before we go into the topic, let me summarize why automotive needs high-speed communication lines. I think it's quite obvious for most of you that the cable harnesses and the need to basically exchange signals, transmit signals, and get basically signals from sensors and the processing them have been crucial in order to enhance the automobile safety. And that's why automobile companies are developing all kinds of solutions, which is called altogether the advanced driver assistance systems, which is ultimately going to the autonomous driving area. And these are critical elements which are being now adapted to the vehicles that will be later on used for actually allowing the autonomous driving to really work. Different applications and the devices are basically, I just took the most important ones or the most popular ones. Short-range radars, we all know these are basically the helping us with the parking and so on. Then we have basically infrareds as well. These are more for the medium range, more for the premium cars at the moment, such as lidars as well. So these are similar to the infrared. It's basically laser detector for longer range, which may also provide some night vision compared with combined with the infrared. So these really are the next step towards the safety, especially during the night driving. And we are all familiar with about surround cameras, short range or park assist, and then the longer distance cameras as well, which are helping with the lane assist, the traffic vision system. Those are basically providing longer range vision. Which all these systems actually requires a lot of cabling, as most of these sensed and basically signals are transferred via cables. And yeah, the cables actually and the cable harnesses in today's cars are getting more and more complex and taking basically 1/3 of the car weight and about 20% of the car cost. So a lot of companies are trying to work on advanced solutions, how to reduce this basically massive amount of wires. That's why advanced techniques about higher speed communication lines on basically more lean cables or high speed bus types of communication networks are being developed. And basically the main drivers and the reasons is that the sensors and the cameras which are necessary with higher image resolution, they can be actually providing more visibility, more safety to the driver and the car and an autonomous driving mode. But it requires obviously data bandwidth, high speed data lines are required. Then the second one is the safety features, which require reliable data transfer. So this reliable data transfer is the second big challenge. And the third one is basically cable size weight reduction and the reduction of the complexity by actually keeping them reliable. In terms of the reliability, and when you try to basically improve the speed and reduce the cable size, more and more noise intrusion are coming into the play, and noise filtering and basically the immunity improvement are critical in order to make these systems and the newer systems work. And there are two actual medium which is recently have been introduced and being introduced still in today's car in terms of the allowing high-speed data lines communication in order to reduce the weight and complexity is the two twisted wire pairs. So this is common for A square B and different type of Ethernet communication physical interfaces. And the second one is the single line coax. This is mainly related to cameras. So if you take a quick look on the twisted wire pair and the advantages, it's very basically inexpensive. It's an unshielded twisted wire pair. This allows a quite high speed communication and it's very flexible, lightweight. And basically the twisting helps to pick up less electromagnetic interference, but it's not fully immune against. And we will see some examples later on. The other one is the coax cable. Coax cable, we know, I mean, most of our homes, basically the internet is cable, the landline is coming through a coax. Coax allows very long transmission lines to operate safely and reliably because of an introduced metal shield. So there is a dielectric insulation, so that keeps quite some distance in order not to allow basically noise intrusion and coupling on the shielding. And the shielding, if it's grounded at the two wire points, two nodes, basically allows to have almost a full immunity from external noises. But of course, it's more expensive, it's more rigid, so it's less easy to assemble. the other big one and the big thing about the coax cable is that it has basically a significant size of lead wire, copper wire, that allows to transfer power without significant signal modification. And you can actually transfer quite some power, being able to power the cameras itself. So you can save basically two additional cables. So let's take a deeper look into the power over coax and basically how to improve the noise immunity. Even though I mentioned if this is a fully shielded cable, and especially if it's grounded at the ends, it's really from the external noises, it's quite free and quite immune. What if we combine the data signal or the data line, the AC data line, with a DC current? So if you want to power the cameras from the distance using just the coax cable, so this is why it's called power over coax concept, then we may introduce some noise in the line. If you're familiar with the power supplies and power electronics, you know that there is basically front end and the back end of these devices, which requires to have some different frequencies to be used. The back end is mainly for the control signals, and the front end is for the signal on itself. And those may have some interference with some noises that is introduced by the power sources and the power regulators at the camera side. So at the ECU side, actually there is a power conversion normally from the battery voltage down to 5 to 12 volt DC. Different IC manufacturers or controller manufacturers use different voltage levels for the DC power over coax concept. So between the serializer and deserializer, the voltage may range normally to 5 to 10 volts, but they try to improve it a little bit further. Normally 5 to 8 volt. Let's put it this way. That's the typical way. So when you do a power conversion, you always introduce some noise, and I will talk a bit more about that. And you will need basically a DC line filter at the entrance of the coax cable before the connector, and the same when you exit, because here you have also power regulators. So from this lower voltage transferred from the ECU, you actually produce different voltage levels in order to power the camera, in order to power the signaling systems, and some auxiliaries as well. And that also backflashes some noises in the system as well and introduce. So let's see a bit more in detail what these noises and the nature of these noises. So since this concept is actually immune from the external, let's say, radiated noises, we only need to focus here on the conducted noises. So the conducted noises are actually mainly introduced by the switchboard power supplies, namely the transistors and MOSFETs and the transformers and inductors during the switching cycle. They always have a little bit of ringing depending on the parasitic capacitances. And this is basically the harmonics allows to introduce to them, actually to the power lines, quite some noise. So you can see here an example. This is actually 300 kilohertz switching mode power supply. And as you can see that there is basically quite some noise. So obviously there is a big noise when the MOSFET is flipping the switch. So and then when it starts to ring, and may introduce, depending on the inductor, the transformer use, some voltages, noises, and you can see the distribution. So you can see that it's quite high frequency noises may be introduced to the system, both in terms of the voltage and there are some of the current sources. So the voltage source is mainly the switching devices, and the current sources obviously are the inductor transformer, which tries to suppress this noise, but at the same time generating some currents as well and introducing some amplification in the system as well. In terms of the form of the noise, there may be two different types. We normally talk about differential mode and common mode noises, depending on where it is being coupled. So the common modes are normally resulted by the previously mentioned ringings, and naturally the physical properties of the MOSFETs and the inductors transformers. That's being actually on the component level, try to basically suppressed and improved as much as possible. So today's MOSFETs and inductors transformers are pretty well shielded. But there is also something which is called the common modes that is basically these interferences coupling to normally the external housing of the equipments that may be coupled to the ground and that will introduce a noise in a ground loop form. And that's even more a bit tricky to filter out, but it's not impossible. In terms of the POC specifically, we mainly need to focus on the differential mode noise filtering. So that's the experience, what it shows. And there's a quite simple way to handle that. So in terms of the POC, the DC line filter design, we need to make sure to actually try to have the DC line as much DC as possible. So any noise which will be introduced, we should filter before it enters the cable, also before we enter the power line of the cable. And the requirements normally are that obviously we need the low DC resistance or impedance, so normally below 1 ohm. Otherwise, the conversion and the transfer of the power would be a bit lossy. And because we need to carry about 300 milliamps without any significant saturation. So that it's also a requirement in terms of the filter inductors to have this kind of feature and not losing too much inductance over the saturation. And in talking about automotive, that may be also challenging because of the temperature range we need to take into consideration. And ferrites normally being used for this kind of applications being notorious to drop inductance and then increase basic saturation by the temperature increase. And we need also high impedance at the utilized frequency bands. So the frequency bands may be actually, and that has to be about over 1 kilo ohms because, with the transmission line is 50 ohm impedance, and normally we require about 20 times higher impedance in order to suppress the noises, especially in that range where we where basically the back end and the front end frequencies are. So the, for the control, it's normally 1 to 5 megahertz, and for the front end, for the camera signal, it's 35 megahertz to 2 gigahertz. Because we need to talk about the range. So normally there is 35 megahertz, 50 megahertz, or 75, 100 megahertz frequency baseline. And you need to take normally about 10 times higher in order to make sure that the different kind of noises are not interfering with the signal as well. So that's why I was taking all the way up to 2 gigahertz. So that 1 kilo ohm should be there for, depending on what the actual baud rate of the specific data line is. So actually the solution would be a properly tuned inductors in series, because you will see that one inductor that, alone will not be able to, or where there is no inductor developed so far, which would be suitable for this job, even though we also try to develop specific inductors for these applications, but currently it's not really possible. And we need to implement also some parallel damping resistors, which are normally 1 to 5 kilo ohms, in order to avoid basically ringings at high frequencies. So there might be a level, especially for the back end filter in the inductor, that may have or reach a very high reactance, but both of the inductors may get into a situation if there is a very high level of high frequency noise introduced that may provoke some ringing. So damping resistor is a good idea to have. So and then we can basically have a bidirectional AC communication and a one directional DC in a filtered way. So as you can see, there is a capacitor. So the AC line is obviously disconnected from the, isolated from the cable itself, and the DC line is directly connected. Okay. In order to find the right inductor, so first let's take a look at the real inductor behavior. So inductors, I normally say, I've worked more than like 12 years with inductor and inductors, and they kind of have a soul. So they are quite sensitive devices in some ways. So we need to be really careful. So when we want to select the right inductors for a specific application, then we really need to take into consideration many aspects. Because inductors, the real inductor performance and also the impedance, as you can see, depends on some variables. The first one and the most important one is the current level. So this makes the core to be saturating and implement more losses as it works at more saturated ways. And second one is frequency. It's partially because it has to do some things with the core loss, but mainly the skin effect. So depending on the wire types we are using, it's a round wire, flat wire, or a foil wire. At high frequencies, the current path, the electrons will line up around the edges of the in the skin of the conductor, and that actually generates some losses. And that's because of the eddy currents introduced. But that's a special topic. But anyway, the higher frequency basically introduces a lot of losses, and inefficiencies, and the temperature. The temperature is some of the cores, normally the ferrite cores, used in the industry, they are sensitive for temperature, so they affect the core saturation. And the winding has also normally used copper winding, and the copper has a high temperature, relatively high temperature coefficient. So at high temperature, the losses and the DCR is actually increasing. So being said that, here you can see a pretty advanced model for an inductor. If you want to make a simulation in SPICE or some similar physical simulator programs. And what you can see here is like the self-resonance frequency, quality factor, which are actually quite important in terms of the noise filtering capability. And that's something which we need to take into consideration and take a deeper look based on the data sheets or by consulting with the manufacturers, especially measure the different temperatures and the different load conditions, because that has a lot to do with finally the filter capacity. All right. Just an example how real inductor looks like. This is our DRA127. This is a very popular automotive inductor type. And as you can see, there is no ideal inductor. So actually the inductance level, it really depends on the frequency applied, such as the impedance, which is which has a lot to do about when you develop a filter. You can see here the reactance and the quality factor. They all actually are related together, and it all depends on the interwinding capacitance. So because of the interwinding capacitance, we go back to the model. So we have basically a capacitance introduced here that actually results basically some level of self-resonance frequency. And before that, the inductor pretty much works as an inductor past the self-resonance frequency. It has rather a capacitance-like behavior. All right. So example for the inductor selection. So I mentioned earlier that one inductor will not make it work. So if you want to filter in basically two different bands, we need to normally use at least two inductors in series. So the back end, if you look at the range of frequencies and then the impedance level, so the impedance level is straightforward. It's 1,000 ohms in both cases, but the frequency actual band is different. So one would or aim for the back end is to find an inductor that is having at least 1,000 ohms between the 1 to 5 megahertz range. And that's an easier one to find, actually. So you may also calculate based on the standard calculation formulas about how much inductance you may need for having a specific impedance. But you also may just consult the data sheets and whether to take basically use the measure, the plotted performance in terms of the frequency response of a specific inductor. So here I was just taking a high runner like DRA74151, so it's a 150 microhenry. So here you need about 100 to 330 microhenry inductor, which needs to carry at least 300 milliamps. In this case, this one can do a 0.65 amp, which is good enough. That means that even at higher temperatures due to some saturations, it will still maintain characteristics of the impedance above this mark and in this range. It's 0.65 ohms, so we were discussing about a maximum of 1 ohm solution. And the more tricky one is to find something from the front end, because here you need a very high frequency tuned inductor, and that requires basically a very low inductance value, and it has to be also quite high impedance which is quite a challenging one to do. So normally the inductors, especially in this range, power inductors, we try to tune them in terms of efficiency in a way that the impedance we try to bring down as much as possible. So this one, particularly the HCME0503, that's kind of like an older design, which still has a bit higher, actually, impedance in this range. But actually, I can tell that, because especially in this range, like 1 to 2 megahertz, it's very important how much impedance we have. So that has basically a correlation with the overall efficiency, AC efficiency, or AC loss of the inductor. So we try to bring this down as much as possible, but that will also affect basically the higher frequency impedances as well. So we need to actually deliver here a quite low efficiency power inductor. So it requires a little bit of a special tuning. So for a 50 megahertz channel or 50 megahertz baud rate or the channel of 52, which requires a quite good filtering between 50 and 500 megahertz, yeah, this inductor would be a choice. Now, there are different other inductors that could be taken into consideration. So in the series connection, you can see that the overall performance is like here. So it's way over between the 1 megahertz and 50 megahertz range. It's way over the 1000 ohm mark. So that's a good solution, for example. But it's really just a lucky constellation. And when it comes to over 50 megahertz, then the selection of inductors are getting more challenging. So there could be, and one option could be ferrite beads in series connection, but because of the saturation, so here you can see like a ferrite bead, it's a multi-layer, a very low efficiency, actually cheap inductor. But as you can see that they are quite sensitive on the saturation. So if you talk about the 300 milliamps to being transferred, the impedance level is actually quite dropping, and finding basically a good one is impossible. So you would need about 4 or 5 pieces different inductance wire you tuned in to connect in series. That is a bit inefficient. So the overall impedance or overall resistance would be a bit higher than 1 ohm and quite inefficient because you need to take into consideration this rating as well. So our recommendation for 50 megahertz, a special tuned inductor, so like our WCLA, so that's basically a special ferrite product wire one, and we have some the lower inductance wire use with very high frequency tuning, appropriately set, basically stray capacitance that is able to provide a high, high impedance filter capability. For that, and for the back end, for the controls, very standard inductor just does the job. So that's about the POC, and if we want to touch base the Ethernet world, I brought you some example and some products. What is the right solution for automotive Ethernet? I was taking into consideration the 100-1000 base T1. So this is basically just a physical connection between two nodes. It's not a bus connection like the T1S. The T1S is still being quite a challenging one in terms of the filtering, but that's gonna come in the future to replace like CAN bus or add some, where you don't need a very high, actually a data rate, then they're gonna be actually the, the right one, but currently there is not too much efficient filtering strategy. So these are something which is in works. What is currently established and being used now in the automotive world is the T1. So let's see the nodes physical layer in terms of this the T1 structure. So as you can see that there are two connectors. So basically this is just physical connector, and the twisted wire is very simple. It's really just an unshielded twisted wire, and you have basically a full duplex signal delivery, and in terms of the in terms of the input, so the or the physical layer, it is very well defined. So there has been an associated or basically a group of companies, an alliance group, which is called the Open. So this is the this is an alliance group which is trying to govern the standards in order to have it an open basically a universal alignment on the, between the nodes and allowing to have the Ethernet properties and then the features implemented for automobiles. It has been quite challenging actually. So in terms, especially for in terms of the noise emission, for example, mainly the noise emission and also the noise susceptibility was quite high for the standard Ethernet. So the base T1 is specifically developed for automotive in order to comply with the automotive OEMs requirements. And the Open Alliance is formed by many automotive OEMs as well, but still being regulated by the IE. So that, there are some special, the BW and the BP standards that are governing actually the signal integrity and so on, and some special standards governing the immunity by the ESDs basically implemented, because in vehicles that's also quite like a concern. So as you can see, the setup, there is after the connector there's an ESD protection device that good to be placed right behind the connector. We have also some solutions for that already, and of course there are some decoupling, some setting of the communication lines, and there is an isolating capacitor, and then there is a common mode choke. So basically that's quite like a closed loop between the two, between the transmitter and the receiver. And these components and the setup of all these are governed by the Open Alliance group. This way it allows actually to use unshielded twisted wire pair up to 50 meter maximum length between the nodes, which is quite sufficient for automobiles. Now let's see a bit about how EMI and electromagnetic interference is introduced, radiated noise is introduced into these networks, and how it's really being canceled. So as I mentioned, the transmission is basically in differential mode, so it's a full duplex. So basically the sum of these signals are taken into consideration by both ends. And if there is an EMI, so if there was an unshielded, basically an untwisted wire, then any type of electromagnetic interference, which is producing radiated emission, this may be basically on the PC board, many basic components. So we talk about the transformers, the inductors, the MOSFETs, some of the lines may be coupled to ground or just forming some loops and acts as an antenna. So in automobiles, there are a lot of noises, and as well as basically the natural control frequencies, wireless frequencies that may be interfered and will be certainly coupled on the unshielded Ethernet lines. And if they are not basically not being twisted, then the noise level is quite significant. So you can see a distortion over the potential signals. And this is actually mirrored on both ends, both cables. Now, if you are twisting the wires, this actually reduces it somewhat, but it will never cancel it. So it will it will do some damping, because these twisted wires, actually the current generated by these noises actually will extinguish each other in some way. But in order to completely clean them and clear them, there is a common mode filter necessary that will actually restore the signal integrity or the signals and make sure the signal integrity is there. So that's why the common mode filter for all kinds of automotive Ethernet, being just a single point-to-point or being a bus system will be a critical item. And that's why there is a very specific standard developed for that. Now, if you look at the all kinds of potential radiated frequencies in cars, yeah, you can see that there are quite some. So starting with the power converters, which may be the mostly present, basically you have a lot of harmonics. And even though there are very effective filters for power supplies, there will be some coupled and there will be some picked up by the Ethernet cables, because you know in automobiles they're quite high density cabling and also on the PC boards are getting shrink down and being compressed as much as possible, so the noise intrusion is more and more present. And yeah, you can see the other ones, so the basically what may be still interfering, the tri pressure monitor or FM bands. Yeah, and then basically the car access systems as well. So there might be quite some noises that can be coupled to in the range where the Ethernet lines are quite sensitive, named from like 1 megahertz all the way to like 125, 150 megahertz. So that's really the range where we need to tune a filter in order to make sure that anything which is a common mode noise, because here we don't that much talk about differential mode. So the signal itself is differential mode. The noise is most of the time coming in the form of the common mode noise. So we need to design basically a very good common mode filter for that range. Now, in terms of the requirements, Open Alliance came up with a quite strict set of requirements. So of course, it's all defined actually, and that's why I put it here. So it's very well precisely defined by the standard requirements. So they are now the version 2.0, and it's available for public. So you can download and consult. So there is a lot of requirements in terms of S parameter models. So these are quite standard for data lines and transmission. Mostly, actually, it's as I translate them to like practical filter specific requirements, then we can actually say that they definitely require heavy common mode noise filtering. So we talk about at least 1 kilo ohm, but rather like 2 kilo ohms in a wide range. So we talk about the 1 megahertz all the way up to like about, depending on the 100 base or the 1000 base, but all the way up to like 150 megahertz, and the low differential mode filtering, especially for the clock signals, which are ranging from 33 to 125 megahertz, because these are basically signals being a differential mode. So it's not good if we suppress the signals itself. Normally, the line impedance is set to about 100 ohm. So the lower we stay is the better we get. And the low insertion longitudinal conversion loss. So if you talk about the eco, it's again going down to low intervining capacitance, not too much energy stored in the form. So basically the signal is passed through without any suppression. So it has a lot to do with the differential mode filtering capability and the low ESD susceptibility. So since the cables are accessible, these Ethernet cables and unshielded during the car, basically maintenance, the car assembly, and just by the charge up because of some problems, actually there might be some ESD strikes quite often happening. And that's why basically, Open Alliance specifically describes the way the ESD suppression function to be developed. We also have solutions for that, and we know very well why it actually has been important. But it's also important for the the common watch chok itself. So it has to have, basically, it has to be, has to survive many ESD shocks and make sure that it's not damping the ESD process too much. Otherwise, the ESD suppressors will not be able to work properly and will not be able to get triggered. That means that even like 100 watt signals or 100 watt, basically form of pulses may hit the communication ICs. That's definitely going to damage them and able to carry about 50 milliamps current. So these are basically translated to the requirement for the filter itself. And if you think about how to design a filter or what are the main aspects to take into consideration for the design, is that we need to find the minimum size. The larger size filters have basically, we basically introduce more intervening capacitance as the larger windings and more connection surfaces are there. So the self-resonance frequency, which is highly dependent on the stray capacitance or intervening capacitance, will not be high enough. Here, the best is to set for like a 100 base T one version. We need to tune it to about 66 megahertz. For the 1000 base, it's better to keep over 100 megahertz in terms of when it comes to the self-resonance frequency and large enough core size. So we need to withstand basically an RF saturation test. So it can't actually drop the performance by introducing a higher level of signal. So the core needs to be sized like that. And minimum interwinding stray capacitance, that's probably the most challenging aspect when it comes to the design of the filter. Because that will have an effect on the differential mode filtering and the insertion loss as well in parallel. And high enough inductance, of course, in order to maximize the common mode filtering over 1 kilo ohm, we need to actually maximize as much as possible the common mode filtering without having too much interwinding capacitance. And we need to tune it to the right frequency range. And as well as not too high resistance and core mobility in order to avoid basically the ESD pulses to suppress below 125 watt. And of course, all goes down to a very tight coupling between the windings and very precise winding control reproduction. So it's not only enough to make it once or make it in a laboratory and do. That's the easy thing to do because we do a try as much as we want and finally it happens. But when it comes to mass production and automotive, we need to basically provide the same performance passing all these requirements. So that's very, very important. So that's quite some challenges, actually. So I must admit that when we started to develop the right product for this application, that was quite some iteration by the time we got to the right solution, because some of these are, I wouldn't say counterproductive by each other, but we really had to optimize and find the right size and the right solution. So that's basically why we ended up with a special product, a special part number addressing basically these filter requirements. So we have a line of filters already, the AC, E series. So it's an automotive common mode filter family that is tuned for the CAN bus filter. And we had a high enough inductance value, which looked to be really promising. The toroids were not an option. So we also have toroid filters. But if you look at the characteristics, which is required for this kind of application, so basically a wide range, high common mode filter capability, and the very low differential mode, then it's a no way. So in manufacturing, we can't control toroids that well. So basically, we ended up on a precision wand chip cores that seems to be the best option. And it may have basically high enough inductance, even though we had to develop a very special core set as well to allow the right right set of configurations. So we had a product which was tuned for CAN bus, and we tried, and actually it failed. It looked really good, except of the basically the different mode filtering. So it went a bit above the 100 ohm mark, and that actually caused a lot of problem at the mix mode signal. So it had a bit of a reflection and echoing. So it really didn't work out, and we had to actually completely redesign the product. The AC2 3225-201-R, that looks identical to the previous one, but the performance is actually way different, and as well as the winding structure, the core set is different. And that's how we could get basically to the optimum performance. So this is something that the product has been specifically tuned according to an open alliance requirements, and already certified as well. You can see that there's not too much different between the two, but still, so we could elevate a little bit the common mode filter capability overall over the line. And we could keep basically a differential mode between the 100 ohm mark over the full range of frequencies. That is, for example, this product is for like the 100 base T, 1000 base T is going to be higher frequency one with lower inductance. And the result, that's quite impressive. So when we submitted our parts and submitted for the testing by Open, they could basically tackle all the, I believe it was like 10 different type of S parameters. I just put here a couple of examples. So it has been really critical in terms of the, obviously for the return loss. So and the common mode rejection. Obviously, this is the main purpose of this inductor. And the insertion loss was really, really critical. So in order to not to distort the signal, we had to get below the one decibel mark. And you can see this inductor tackled that. So it's really one below 100 megahertz. It's falling below the 10 decibel mark. And it has a quite good differential to common mode rejection as well in all different testing configuration, which has been the challenging portion. So that results by a special core set, which we use for this one. Also, it's very important that the return loss in terms of pre and post ESD. So you can see that after some ESD strikes, the product is not deteriorating, so not changing anything on the performance. And even if the signal strength is basically pushed to the limit and maximum, the common mode rejection still remains the same. So it's really not sensitive. So the core is basically quite good enough to handle that. And also, that was again a challenging portion in order to keep the ESD strike so that it could pass basically the ESD voltage, at least with a 125 volt, in order to safely activate and fast activation allow for the ESD suppressors in order to actually shunt all the over voltage to the ground before it would actually receive or being delivered to the communication ICs and the controllers. So this part is pretty good. We actually have a line of these, so mostly tuned for the CAN bus, and some of them to A2B and USB and so on. And the 2V versions are specifically tuned for Ethernet. It's an automotive grade one mostly, so also ready for high temperature applications. And quite like the standard sizes we try to tackle in order to meet the basically the competition footprints as well. And you can see basically an overview about both the common mode filters and the ESD suppressors that have been qualified for this kind of applications. So hopefully, this session allowed you to take a bit deeper look into the filtering world of these high-speed communication sequences. We have obviously many additional materials and help on our website in order to help you to find the right solutions. And obviously we are ready for questions now and ready to help you with your designs if it comes to, if the time comes. So thank you very much for the attention, and I'm opening the Q&A session now.
The presentation is available for download, so navigate over to the Handouts tab in the upper right corner of your screen to access this file. And we've got a few questions that have come in. We've got a little bit of time here before we head up to the end of the hour, but you can still submit your questions if you have them. So first off, you described earlier in your presentation a complex inductor model that could be used in SPICE simulations. Does Eaton provide SPICE models similar to that for your inductors?
Yes, absolutely. So some of them, or most of them, can be downloaded from the website. We also provide some advanced ones, specifically for LT SPICE and P SPICE, that, yeah, in which also actually demonstrates or simulates or allows to simulate the saturation based on the current level. So that's more important for the power inductors, though. But those can be those gonna be available soon, and then by consultation or by request we can send them as well.
Excellent. The next question we have submitted to us was, how does a bus-like high-speed communication line protection, how does that look, for example, in case of A to B?
A square B is a tricky one. So actually, it's a bit of a combination of the power over coax and the automotive Ethernet. Likewise, the 1000 base T1. So that's basically a bus network which carries multiple types of signals, but they are not fully duplex. So we talk about A square B and A square C, audio signals, control signals, and maybe some others as well. And that's why there are very specific bands to be actually protected and filtered. So it's actually comprised of Kamomo choke, similar to our ACE, the 2V3225. Normally it's 100 or 200 microhenry one. So the suppression capability is not that much critical or heavy like in case of the one that we just went through with. But it's more important to have very well balanced differential to common mode, so the mixed mode filtering capability. So the actual common mode filter needs to be tuned for that. But there is not only a common mode filter necessary here, because here we also need to make sure that all those differential mode signals are passing through without any disturbances. So this is a chain of filters, actually, including ferrite beads, and LC filters as well in series, which actually acts as like a band pass filters or a set of band pass filters. So it's a quite complex. And analog devices, I think, pretty well defined the requirement for that. But it's not an easy one.
Interesting. Next question we have is that automotive applications often run at extreme temperatures for many years. Do designers need to worry about the performance of these inductors and common mode filters and chokes that you talked about degrading significantly over that time and temperature?
That's a good question. Actually, some of them may degrade. Normally, the molded power inductors. So we are well aware of like thermal aging problems, which have been actually resolved over the past, let's say, one decade. In terms of the specific inductors, like these filter inductors, especially which is the ferrite based ones, normally the performance is quite stable. But we actually normally run a bit more extended lifetime testings. So the normal, like an AECQ, so like environmental performance testing, costs for like 1,000 hours. But normally our customers, so when we shoot, especially for the premium range, they require special extended testing. So we normally run by, like, as a basic is like 2,000 hours.
at very high temperature. So we normally, if there is an inductor like tuned for 125, we try to run it a bit higher in order to make sure that the reliability is there. In terms of the windings, we are normally using at least like a 180 degree rated or graded wire or 220. So the in terms of the winding structure, there is not much of a concern. Once the product is soldered, they are normally very robust, actually.
Excellent. Well, it looks like we're just about out of time here, so and covered all the audience questions. So thank you again, Akash, for an excellent presentation and a great discussion during this Q&A. And thanks to our audience for participating.
You,
yeah, you're welcome. And thanks to our audience for the questions and participating. So before we wrap up, I'd like to announce our giveaway for this session. Congratulations to Ray Miller. Our team will be in touch with you after the event to ensure we have all your information and get your giveaway package sent out to you. And I would encourage you all to come back and check out the live sessions tomorrow. And there's actually one late night tonight, at least our time here in the States, but there's a bunch more coming throughout the rest of the week. After we close out here, you'll be redirected to the Industry Tech Days webpage, where you can browse readily available resources and sign up for the other presentations. So thank you everyone for your time, and we look forward to seeing you again at another live session later this week.
Thank you. Bye-bye.